So that's kind of our footprint. And there, each one of those stations has a dedicated reporter like me covering ag and rural issues. My background is on a farm. I grew up in southwest Iowa on a corn soybean farm. So I grew up doing all that fun farm stuff. And that's my credibility for this issue. We'll go down and introduce ourselves down the line. Ryan, why don't you start?
Hello, my name is Ryan Soderlin. I'm a staff photographer at the Omaha World Herald. Give you a little background about myself. I grew up in the sheep capital of the nation, which is Newell, South Dakota. It's a town of about 600 people. Didn't get to graduate there. I ended up actually graduating from Grant High School in Grant, Nebraska. And now I drove myself in a pickup load of stuff to UNL and following my dad, and I was like, how am I going to drive in this big city of Lincoln, Nebraska? But we got over that and ended up graduating with in sort of emphasizing photography more than writing. And I took small newspaper jobs. My first one was in Gillette, Wyoming. Then I went to Salina, Kansas as a staff photographer. And then I was the photo editor in the Casper Star Tribune in Casper, Wyoming. Then I was a photo editor at the Rapid City Journal in Rapid City, South Dakota. And now I'm back here in Nebraska. So that's me.
Sionegada, Lenzy Krehbiel-Burton the Wada. My name is Lenzy Krehbiel-Burton. I'm from Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm the token non-Nebraskan, Iowan, Kansan in this joint today. So I have a few visual aids to help you guys at least get some semblance of an idea of how in the wide world of sports I got here. That's my hometown, Tulsa, Oklahoma. I did not grow up on a farm. I have grandparents that live in small towns. My grandmother lives in our family farm that has been in our family since prior to statehood, but I am a city kid through and through. However, life takes a funny hop sometimes. I'm a full-time freelancer, and as Carson alluded to, you don't always get to pick your jobs. So by sheer dumb luck, most of my clients have me covering out in small towns and in rural Oklahoma. And as many of you are probably aware, Oklahoma, we call ourselves Native America. We are home to 38 federally recognized tribes, and most of my coverage has me in Indian country. This is Osage County. I don't know if any of you are fans of the Pioneer Woman on Food Network or are familiar with August Osage County. Yeah, this, not everybody looks like Benedict Cumberbatch up there, sorry. This is a normal view on any given day. Two of my regular clients are based out of Osage County. Southwest Oklahoma, Fort Sill Apache Complex, about 45 minutes northwest of Lawton or an hour southwest of Oklahoma City, depending on your geographic bearings. Stillwell, Oklahoma, my husband's hometown. Far eastern Oklahoma, self-proclaimed strawberry capital of the world. 5,000 people there on a good day. And about, well, up until recently, about 20,000 chickens. Thank you, Tyson. Give you some idea roughly on what I cover, where I have to go. In Indian country is all over the state. So, and yeah, you see up there, 60 to 77 counties are officially considered rural, but that doesn't, Osage County is actually considered an urban county. Don't let that pump jack fool you, because part of Tulsa spills over into it. And despite nationally, you're seeing more American Indian and Alaska Natives going to cities, that's not necessarily the case in Oklahoma. Yes, there are large indigenous populations in Tulsa, Oklahoma City, and Lawton, but when you're covering Indian country, you gotta go rural. You gotta go out in the hollers. So that's a little bit about me and where I go.
Is that better? Yeah. So I'm Ted Genoways, and at the computer there is Marianne Andrei, who is the photographer on this project and also my wife. We just wanted to introduce a little bit ourselves by talking about a project that we've just concluded that's coming out soon that is actually very much like what Matthew Hansen was talking about, where we got interested, having done a bunch of kind of quick hit stories where we often found ourselves wishing that we could do something that was more in depth and spend more time. There was a family that farms right on the border between York and Hamilton counties that Marianne found. Go ahead and page through them. This is the young woman who's the daughter of the family, Megan Hammond, her father, Rick Hammond, and then Megan's now husband was her boyfriend when we first started the project, Kyle Galloway. And we talked them into this idea of spending a year with them from one harvest to the next on their farm operation there, which is split between a kind of standard soybean and corn operation, and then they've got Angus cattle as well. We thought that they were a good family to follow, partly because they're raising commercial crops, but also raising seed corn for Pioneer. And so covering all of the bases in terms of the kind of standard crop operations, as well as the livestock operation. We're also interested in them as a family because Marianne was the one who first found them when we were working on stories about Keystone XL, and they've got multiple parts of their farm property that will be crossed by the pipeline if the pipeline is built. And so they've taken an active role in opposing the pipeline, and we thought they were an interesting story because they have very much opposed that project at the same time that they are deeply enmeshed into other parts of what we think of as sort of big ag operations by virtue of working with Pioneer, and then a lot of the cattle that they're raising going to the sale barn and winding up with Cargill. Anything else to note about them? Okay. I guess the last thing that I would say, just to return to as Marianne's sort of paging through the last of these, is that our notion in this was that we wanted to do something, as we've talked about these kind of notion of trying to show rural America and to talk about Trump's America in recent months. We really wanted something that would take you through a full year cycle, since that is so much a part of the way that farm operations work, to see the sort of daily stresses at the same time that you're seeing some of the larger transitions that are going on as Megan and Kyle take over the operation from Rick. I think that's it.
Great, thank you all, and thank you all for being here to talk about this stuff. I want to start first with the idea about why it matters to be in these places to tell these stories. And you just mentioned Keystone XL. That's a huge international story, really. Why does it matter to be in these places to tell these stories on the ground? And on top of that, to have someone who's, you know, from the towns that they're from, but from this area to tell them?
Well, and I'll let you take this one too, but to us, one of the things that got us kind of going on covering Keystone XL, especially here in Nebraska, was first of all that the center of resistance was here. That while other states cleared the permitting hurdles and the resistance seemed to be present but not as organized as it was here in Nebraska, that the story was really coming to center here. But the other thing that we thought was important was that while the national press was focusing on, you know, carbon particles per billion, and talking about what the importance of this kind of project to climate change and some of those national and international issues, the ranchers and farmers were talking about their concerns about contamination of the Ogallala Aquifer, and they were talking about the fact that, that eminent domain was being used to get the easements, and that there were there was kind of local and state level corruption that they were concerned about. And to us, it seemed important to say, look, if the center of the resistance is here, then you should know what the issues are that are actually at play, that are becoming the center of that resistance, and to not have that kind of disconnect that seemed to be going on between the national media and what was actually happening on the ground.
And I, I'd like to explain that, you know, Ted is has a family background here in Nebraska. I was born in Kansas. My dad was in the Air Force, but I grew up in Maine, a small town in Maine. I did come to the University of Nebraska as a graduate student and met Ted. And we were in Virginia when the Keystone XL fight really began. But Ted had the connection to Nebraska, and he came back to Nebraska to do the story for On Earth magazine. And it was about that time I was teaching at the University of Virginia. My background's in the history of science. And I picked up a camera at that time, and Ted and I started reporting together. And the we started reporting in DC because it was 2 hours from us. And I don't know, it was 2 years that we were into that story from reporting from Virginia when we decided to move back home and start telling stories from the place where they were happening. And so
well, what was it about that story or that that what was at the root of that feeling?
I don't know if you can help with that. It was it happened to be at a time where we were transitioning away from academia and moving toward journalism. And so my photography was getting better. Ted's writing was getting better. And it was just an opportunity that we had. We thought, well, we could move back home. Our Ted's parents could watch our son while we were reporting together because we were trying to report together from Virginia and had friends watching our son for us. So it all just sort of worked out. But at the same time, we were really drawn to the Keystone story because it had a Nebraska connection. And of course, there's a family connection to Nebraska. I mean, many of you have said, you're from here, you're from the Midwest. So, yeah.
I'll just add something then so we can move to the other panelists. But I guess I would just add that that we were at a point where we were wanting to freelance and were looking at this question of is it possible to be based in Nebraska and be writing for national publications and shooting for national publications and have enough stories and enough work to support that. And Keystone was for us one way kind of in with national publications, but I think also that once we were here and were talking to editors and saying, you know, here are the things that are really on the minds of people here, it was amazing to us to what extent that was absolute news to editors who were in New York or San Francisco. I mean, to a great extent, this place and this part of the country is just invisible. And just being here and being in the sort of flow of what's happening here, that just calling up an editor, sending out pitches and saying, like, this is what's happening, it was astonishing to me how much the reaction was often, I've heard nothing about this, and this is a great opportunity. And I think a lot of times we're under the impression that, that the coasts are ignoring what's happening here, but I think just as often it's just that they don't have people who are present here with an ear to the ground. And so I think there are actually a lot of opportunities for working for national media just by knowing what the daily concerns are here in this part of the country.
Lenzy, what difference do you think it makes having, you know, being in that area, having your ear to the ground when writing a story?
It honestly makes a huge difference. I mean, one of my more regular clients is Reuters, and I've done some work for the New York Times as well. And honestly, I mean, with the New York Times, it's okay, yeah, we have no clue who to talk to. You know the people. you do that voodoo. It's all about the connections. It really is. It's knowing, okay, who's your people? And taking it and running with it.
So, and Ryan, you've worked for smaller papers. So what's the perspective like from there? You know, making sure that these are in smaller communities, but also make sure you're getting out from those smaller communities.
The stories?
Let's see if I'm going to answer this right. Small papers have a concern of, you know, turning out the daily paper. You know, you have to sort of produce X number of pictures and copy to have the daily paper. But sometimes your stories will rise to a more national level. In Rapid City, you know, my parents, their ranch is north of Sturgis, and they didn't lose any cattle, but hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of cattle died. Well, the Rapid City Journal reports that story. It gets picked up by the AP. The AP then cites, hey, maybe we should send somebody out for a bigger story, and then maybe the Times picks it up and says, oh, this could affect the price of beef, or if there's a drought in Texas, or, you know, stuff like that. So working with those small papers, like in Gillette, you know, that's coal country. That's methane gas, you know, in the my understanding, in the 70s, before they started pulling the water off of coal veins, there's a community just outside Gillette called Rawhide where you could light the streets on fire because the gas was coming up. So, you know, these stories are in these small communities because a lot of natural resources are out in the middle of nowhere. So if you think that way, then the state with our beef, Wyoming with its coal and oil, South Dakota with its, you know, tourism. I mean, these are all things that happen in rural America.
This was covered some in the first panel, but I love getting tips from other reporters. So let's say you get an assignment to go cover a story in a small town. How do you break that open? How do you get into a small community? Any tips?
Go hang at the local bar.
The local bar?
Not even kidding. You'd be surprised what people will say and what you pick up. And yes, while sober too.
I think for me, I just try to be who I am when I come into town. I'm probably wearing a lot more relaxed clothing. I'm probably wearing my jeans and button down shirt or something. But first of all, I'm not trying to pretend I'm from there. But yet I'm trying to also let them know and understand that my intentions as a journalist, and that I do, as a person from rural America, you know, have some understanding and some background on what we're, maybe the story we're trying to do. Just be curious, and people will open up to you. But yeah, the bar thing, that is a good, that does help.
And I heard this earlier, just being clear about what you're working on. And you're not trying to pull the wool over anybody's eyes. This is what I'm here to talk about. They know about it, right? They may not open up right away and say they know about it, but to be open up front.
Well, and I would say too, being upfront about being from the outside and arriving because you are curious and because you're wanting to know more, and you're not arriving from a position of authority. You're arriving, in fact, from a position of ignorance, and being fairly upfront about that. I mean, one of my favorite nonfiction writers, Chuck Boden, I mean, said that being a writer is sort of resigning yourself to a life of always being the dumbest person in the room. And it's really true. I mean, you're constantly, if you're doing it right, you're surrounding yourself constantly with people who have spent a lifetime on whatever subject it is that you've just sort of stumbled into. And so you're constantly the person who's asking the elementary questions and having to have somebody who really, really knows this stuff explain it to you. And having a certain amount of humility about that, I think helps, just as an entry point.
Anything else to add?
I think from a photographer's perspective.
Very good.
You really have to have a sense of compassion for the people and the story, and you have to project that if you want people to be comfortable with you and to be able to get the portraits that you need.
How do you project that?
It's hard. I probably don't do it as well as I ought to.
I probably don't do it at all.
Yeah. So you mean...
So as a photographer, not only are you there asking them questions, you're pointing this camera in their face.
Right.
At a person who, probably would rather just you weren't there sometimes. So what are some ways that you help them open up? Yeah. Time.
I think time. Just going to speak on your behalf for a second to say, just interject to say, the thing that I see that Marianne does, having worked with other photographers as well, is just having spending enough time for the subject to get comfortable, to get past that initial sense of someone who's not only from the outside, but like right up in your face, and to allow the person to get at ease enough that wall starts to come down.
Yeah, you can't just walk up to somebody and get a great portrait. You have to spend time talking with them. Oftentimes, I leave my camera in the car for the first few hours until I have... I guess I'm lucky I don't have to get a story in a few hours. We can spend days or hours or days trying to get the story. So I think it's really important, if you can, to be able to spend time with folks and get to know them a little bit so that they do feel comfortable with you.
Lenzy, how much time are you spending in a place, and how much time does it take until you feel like, okay, I kind of understand the people in this place?
Well, part of it depends on who I'm writing for. I mean, I know you guys all probably glazed over my bio, but I write for a lot of different outlets, and some of them use me as a beat reporter. So, I mean, there are places that, okay, yep, hey, what's up, what's going on? I know them fairly well. There are some places where I maybe am only there once a month, if that. When I'm truly parachuting in, and it's honestly been a little while since I've had to be that girl. It honestly just depends, and I hate using this phrase, but it depends on the story. Sometimes I'm lucky and I'm able to have the luxury of spending 2, 3, 4, 5 hours with that person, picking their brain, getting to know them. Sometimes it's nowhere near that long. It's the nature of the business, unfortunately.
But you've done both.
Yes.
So what do you find the difference to be if you're able to spend more time?
It helps build the rapport. It really does encourage them to open up. Maybe not necessarily to the point of somebody a source that I've established over the years. I mean, there are a couple of the papers that I've been with. I mean, one of them I've been with since 2011. So, I mean, those are sources that I've built up a long time versus somebody that I get to spend 5 hours with. Okay, we're not going to be, maybe bosom chums for the rest of our life, but it definitely helps.
Something that I think when I was functioning as a photo editor, we talked about at the newspapers that I worked at was real people doing real things when they're really doing them. And in Casper, if I was going to have to send a photographer 6 hours to make a picture of somebody, the reporter or myself, whoever was setting it up, had to ask the question, will this person let me take their picture? So you start there, you arrive, and they know why you're there. You've made this initial sort of contact. You gotta get your niceties out of the way. Hi, I'm Ryan. Hi, I'm so and so. I am a coal miner, farmer. Not used to seeing a journalist. And then I get out of the way, and I don't really say anything else. And people, as a photographer, will either go back to what they were doing, And sometimes to make them feel comfortable, I'll tell a little story, but then I go back to being quiet. Because my purpose there is to make pictures, and if I set up the relationship to where they think I'm there to entertain them with my stories and my conversation, I have stepped all over myself. And I've also sort of stepped on them a little bit because they don't have the chance to be who they are with whatever amount of time I have to be with them. And so it's a little bit of a dance I play with myself of like, well, I am a nice, friendly person. I need to establish a rapport, but then I also have to do my job. And so that's kind of how I work it, I guess.
One thing that happens to me about, maybe a third of the time I go visit farmers is, and it doesn't really matter what time of day, you show up at their home and they'll say, you know, welcome, thanks for coming. You need a cup of coffee? And I've learned to not say no and to just say yes. Yes, I'd love a cup of coffee at, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Just because that does, that time, that half hour, just having a cup of coffee allows you to just kind of build that rapport. And for radio, that's, it's so important to have someone to feel comfortable talking just like this before you ever stick a microphone in their face. So that's something I've picked up along the way.
Ryan, I actually have a question for you on this subject.
Sure.
There's a photograph of yours that I wonder if you would talk a little bit about how it was made. The photograph of some of the group of kids that are chopping the heads off of chickens and plucking the chickens. Because, I mean, when you said real people doing real things at the time that it's really happening, it's a great example of that, but also just all of the things that you have to balance in terms of like what farmers want people to see in the paper and what they are nervous about having certain, especially urban audiences seeing.
Sure.
And a little background on the story I was part of?
Yeah, one of the things that this family had been photographed before by the World Herald, and so we already sort of had a relationship with them. And I think Kent Sievers had done the pictures, and over the last 10 years since, or maybe less, since the paper had revisited the family, the farmer had gone blind. And so I, show up in my little red pickup, and I say, hi, I'm Ryan, I'm here. And they kind of already knew that what to expect from a World Herald photographer. And she said to me, the wife said, you're just going to want us to ignore you, right? And I said, yes. That is exactly what we're after. But so I just slowly made pictures and spent the entire day with them and just asked them questions about their day as they were going. And they said, well, would you want to stick around? We're going to, our daughter's in charge of raising our hens, which help us make money, and these butcher chickens. And, would you want to stick around for that? And I was like, yeah, that'd be great. And they didn't have any qualms about it at all. And I tried not to make it, it had to pass the Cheerios test for, And so I respected that in my, in my head. I had that in my mind and respect who they were and why I was there in the first place. And that was to tell their story of how they live their life versus, making maybe a more sensational type of picture. But yeah, they just trusted me right away, and we just had a nice rapport.
I think, as much as any other media organization, Harvest and NET have, since the election, kind of been wringing our hands, like, how are we doing covering rural areas? And what is the image that we're portraying of rural places, and is it accurate? Are we doing a good job of this? And I think what you're saying is real people doing real things when they're really doing it is an antidote for some of that, to trying to keep from portraying too much of an idealized image or too much of a sensational image. To that, that's like one of the most rural things you can imagine, right? But it's real, right? And that's what it's like. And there are also images that are the most unlikely thing.
Right, and I think
part of that building that rapport with that family was I could tell them a story about me growing up and how my dad would butcher chickens, and then he would throw the chicken at me because he thought it was funny, you know? That, you know, and then you sort of have this rapport and a story, and I think it's, you share your life to the extent that you help people understand you and why you're there.
Lenzy, when you're covering Native communities in Oklahoma, does it vary depending what publication you're working for, how they react to what you're doing?
It not only varies by what publication I'm doing, by what tribe. Mm-hmm. You got to remember, 38 federally recognized tribes, 38 different sets of cultures and traditions. Actually, more than that, since some of those tribes were forced together, like Cheyenne and Arapaho, Sac and Fox, forced together, and they all have their own traditions and cultures. So it really, it's a crapshoot.
Well, what I'm thinking about is, you know, this, me thinking about, am I covering rural Nebraska in an accurate image? Mm-hmm. Must be a particular question when you're covering.
It is very, very much so. With some of the tribes that I cover more frequently, it's not as big of an issue because, you know, oh, it's you. Okay, who are you working for today? But it does affect the questions I have to ask to help paint a fuller picture. Like if I'm writing for the Tulsa World or for Reuters, there's a lot more background information that has to go in versus if I'm writing for the Big Heart Times, which is in Osage County, self-proclaimed only paper in the world that really gives a diddly. Not even kidding. It's on the masthead, folks. BarnstallTimes.com. There's my shameless plug. Versus if I'm writing for Big Heart Times, it's, oh, okay, yeah, we know what's going on. What's the update?
And for different editors, what's that like?
other than having to keep a running list of, oh, God, who am I calling today? It's, again, very, okay, these are the questions I know they're going to want answered. Or if I come at it from this angle, what are the chances of it getting rejected? Or, hey, wait a minute, this is great. Why didn't I think of it? Mm-hmm. So,
have you ever had to push back?
Oh, yeah, all the time. Occupational hazard of being a freelancer.
Is there a story that it comes to mind that you wouldn't mind sharing?
I don't want to jeopardize the whole panel. the first one that actually comes to mind, 2011, I covered my tribe's election. The Cherokee Nation election, which normally, Cherokee Nation is the largest federally recognized tribe in the country. And normally, the election would be fairly cut and dry. Yeah, this one ran for 4 months. There were all sorts of court, and there was a recount. They wound up having to do a do-over, basically, because of questions in the counting. And I remember having to explain to my editors multiple times, okay, no, you know, we can't just have folks hanging out in the hollers talking nonstop to the tribal council members. We actually have to treat, you know, yes, there is the cultural component, but this is also a government. We need to make sure that the same standard of accountability that we would apply to Tulsa City Council or another government, we need to make sure that we're holding the Cherokee Nation tribal government to the same standards, the judiciary to those same standards, and asking those same questions. I am not going to throw softballs at a tribal judge just because he has a CDIB card. For those of you not familiar with the acronym, sorry, CDIB, Certificate Degree of Indian Blood, it's this lovely little card that says, yes, I'm an enrolled member of such and such tribe as issued by the feds.
Literally card carrying.
Yeah.
So thinking about the image we portray in our stories of rural areas, how much... If a reporter has gone to a place, and how much damage can a bad reporter do to trying to build a relationship and you know, just having people be open to talk to reporters? Have you ever gone to a place where someone's been burned, and what was it like trying to reopen that door?
I'm still working on that with a few communities.
Do you know what happened? Like.
In one particular community, it was just bad facts, late, basically someone doing call center journalism. I heard something on Facebook. I'm going to call a couple of people and see what they say and then write it up. So it happens, unfortunately. And there was a kernel of truth to the Facebook fake news, so to speak, but having to get to it became that much harder through a colleague's sloppiness.
One comment that it was actually an op-ed that I saw, I think in the Lincoln paper by the head of the Nebraska Communities Foundation, was reacting to what he says were bleak stories and bleak headlines about rural areas when some census data came out. And sort of pushing back against I've heard this before, the media always focuses on the negative, what's happening in small towns. You're never focusing on the positive, and a lot of things that Matt talked about are stories that can focus on the positive or the negative. And not all the stories are positive, not all the stories are negative. There's just a whole lot in between. And we're tasked with going to cover places that are really struggling and places that are doing really well. But it just got me thinking about how do you approach it differently if you're going to a community where, this is something that they're going to see written up and they may not be too happy about it. Have you had an experience covering kind of a negative story in a small town, and how did you go about that differently from maybe a different story?
So I'll start by saying that I spent years working in Fremont, Nebraska, which is a way of saying
yes.
Years of working in a community where there's a lot of negative stuff going on and a lot of warring factions. And the thing that was strange to me, I would, and I don't know how much I ended up writing about Fremont all told, a lot, but simply by continuing to talk to all groups involved and interviewing everyone, letting them have their say, I was really stunned, frankly, by how fairly everyone felt that they were treated. And I say that I felt stunned because I felt that in something that was originally written for Harper's, which is very much a kind of perspective journalism venue. It's someplace that comes out of an sort of an essay tradition. And then a book that was intended in that way as well, I didn't think that my perspective was ever in doubt. And I guess I should say that by way of background, especially for people watching from afar, I mean, Fremont was one of the communities where there was an effort to try to pass, and eventually was an ordinance passed that essentially enlisted local law enforcement in the enforcement of federal immigration laws. And so there was suddenly local penalties for employing people who were in the country without documentation or who were even living in the community without documentation. And to me, a meatpacking town that survived entirely on the labor of immigrants that then suddenly decides that they're not welcome in the town was just sort of starkly hypocritical. And I was, like I said, I was never shy about sharing that perspective. What surprised me was that sitting with people who had very opposing views and being straightforward with them about my opinions and then still trying to portray them as fairly as possible, to not demonize them, but to, portray their perspectives, I was always amazed at how, when stuff would appear, they were always delighted. I heard more from them than I heard from the people who seemed to be sympathizing with them. So, again, I think that as much as it's as there's an antidote to these sorts of things, that just spending the time and being willing to sit down and say, and to be honest about your own, where you're coming from, your perspective, but then open to what's going on in the community. And it's always more complex than you think when you go in.
Other thoughts? Covering a negative story?
I found that working in a smaller newspaper sometimes, a reporting staff can sometimes get bogged down sort of in the minutia of maybe a sticky issue at city council or whatever. And then the state paper will come in and clear it right up. And I think one of the reasons that is the state paper doesn't have sometimes the personal relationships, and not that they're trying to burn relationships or anything like that, but they'll come in and just ask the questions sometimes that maybe some smaller papers are not willing to ask. And so I think sometimes having larger publications in your state, in your region, is sometimes kind of beneficial for things like that. And then at the local level, once that larger publication writes that story, sometimes your smaller paper will be like, will see the forest for the trees and then catch up. So I think that's sometimes that.
So you're talking about the local paper having a harder time covering a negative local story.
Sometimes, yeah. You know, with small towns, everybody knows everybody, and so yeah. Sometimes there can be sort of interpersonal, you know, relationship worries and things like that. So.
Lenzy, anything you wanted to add to that?
No.
Okay. I want to know about. Sorry. Okay. One last question about building networks in rural areas with people. I was wondering if you had any stories or tips about how one person has led to another to a great thing.
When we first came here to Nebraska, Ted and I were both freelancing. Why does it do this?
You get closer.
It's probably your phone.
Right? Is it?
It may be.
The audio people.
So when we first came here to Nebraska freelancing, I worked for Bold Nebraska as a photographer and storyteller for them. I was, for those of you who don't know, Bold Nebraska is an organization who organized around pipeline fighters against the Keystone XL pipeline. And my job was to humanize the farmers and ranchers who were fighting the pipeline so that folks would know that Bold just wasn't a bunch of radical environmentalists, but these were real people in real communities, small town communities here in Nebraska. And now I've forgotten what I'm talking about.
Networks.
The networks.
Thank you. So I started out working with a family from York, Nebraska, and this family, Ted and I decided to work with them for a year and a half to tell a story about from harvest to harvest on this.
So that's where that connection eventually came from.
That's correct.
Yeah. And, well, and just you know, with Bold, it was one of those things where many of the farmers and ranchers who were becoming concerned about the aquifer were then starting to wrestle with kind of other questions. They were, you know, well, what's going on with my, you know, nitrate contributions to surface water? And there were all of these sort of other conversations that started popping up. And so some of the farmers who were involved in Keystone XL are now the ones that are raising the questions about nitrate loads with the Costco plant that's being built in Fremont. And that in some ways I would say what we've done is just found a group of farmers and ranchers who started with one issue, becoming aware of larger issues and thinking about things in different ways, who have then, they've followed those issues on their own into other areas, and we've simply followed along and tried to cover their evolution as it's happening.
Should we open up for questions? Okay. We should take questions from you guys now. Raise your hand if you have a question, and we'll get a microphone your way. Up front.
Yeah, I'm curious, as people who obviously care deeply about small communities and have spent a lot of time there, what are some of the cultural nuances that you've experienced in these places? And I'm talking specifically to the Midwest, that either make it ripe for storytelling and easy, or are sometimes a hindrance. And I'm thinking from personal experience, people here are very humble, and so it can be hard to tear a story out of them and get them to talk about themselves. So I'm wondering if you can just speak to some of those things.
Speaking just primarily from covering Indian country, I mean, I don't know if I've made it abundantly clear or not. I don't just cover Indian country. I have mainstream stuff too that I deal with. But when I cover Indian country, actually just chatting up elders, you'd be surprised. I mean, just sitting down and talking with, it's like sitting down and talking with your grandpa. And they have, sometimes grandpa rambles, but usually the rambling leads to one hell of a story.
I think cultural differences that I notice from, say, the West, ranchers in the West, like states like Wyoming and South Dakota, and then here in Nebraska, farmers, you better kind of know the kind of agriculture that they do. I grew up on, just basically doing hay work, small tractors, a lot more sort of manual stuff. You come to Nebraska, it's all corn and big machinery, and it's different. And you kind of need to know, size of equipment. You want to have a little bit of familiarity with what they're actually doing on their place. So
I think too, the more you have researched your subject, I've found this out recently, that the more you understand exactly, as you said, their type of agriculture. I've been working with a family in the Sandhills, talking about how difficult it is to, ranching is a hard life. Tell me about that. But it was several days of actually asking that question multiple times that I finally heard the best story from this particular rancher, which was that they'd had a tornado come through and destroy 52 head of cattle. And I heard the story from him. I could see that it was a really difficult story. I came back to it multiple times, and each time I found out a little bit more about that story and just how tragic and awful it was and how the community pulled together for them. The neighbors always come to help you, right, in times of tragedy. But he said that this was the most unusual showing of neighbor help. He said before he could even get out to the field, he had recognized that all of his neighbors were there before he got to that field, and he said it was a very difficult field to get to. But I think coming back to the story multiple times, if you have that opportunity, you start to, as they trust you, hear a little bit more.
I would just add that I think one of the really undercovered stories right now in small town America is how diverse these towns are growing because of the depopulating of a lot of small towns, especially in the middle of the country. And then very often the towns, as kind of a lifeline, will bring in some outside industry. I've done a lot of stuff on meatpacking. And what that means is very often a sudden influx of immigrants, recently refugees, and it's remarkable to see how communities that are very small are suddenly grappling with the issues that we think of as being national or international issues. And I think we've found actually that it is a much more sort of human way of getting at these stories, to engage with them at the places where they're happening.
I've had a couple experiences with Farmer Time where, so recently I had an interview set up with a farmer, and it's like I was about ready to leave, and I called him to let him know I was going on the way out. He said, well, I'm in Indiana picking up parts, because that was the day he had to be in Indiana to pick up those parts. And so I've just learned to kind of roll with it. Other questions?
I'm really interested in hearing which journalists covering rural America that each of you admire.
Well, I've long admired Ted's work and Matthew's work. They're in the room, but, you know.
Yeah, who's doing it well?
Who's doing it well? I do think the World Herald does a good job covering rural stories and doing it well, and covering rural issues and rural industries, and I think they do a good job. Some other reporters around here that I Nicholas Bergen at the Journal Star, I think he does a good job. Mm-hmm. And I just thought about this recently. Frank Morris he's associated with Harvest. He's based at KCUR in Kansas City. He just has a hell of a knack for becoming fast friends with people in rural areas, and just kind of fitting right in, and getting tape that I could be there a week, and I would never get that soundbite. That, and not just because it's a crazy soundbite, because that really gets to the heart of it, and he just has a great knack for that. And he's in the public radio world for sure. He's someone I admire there, his work.
I would put in a plug for Christopher Leonard, who. Had a book called The Meat Racket that was about Tyson and sort of contract poultry farming. He's now in sort of the finishing stages of a book about the Koch brothers that, as I understand it, is kind of approaching it from their Kansas roots. And he's also done a bunch of kind of standalone pieces for Business Week. And he's one of those people that whenever he's got something that appears, I'm just really eager to see it. And I think worth noting that, I mean, he was a newspaper reporter for many, many years, and kind of comes at it with that very just daily approach to things, that he's working at these things at a ground level, but then has this national perspective that he's able to bring to it also. And to have the combination of that kind of workmanlike research brought together with, you know, his writing skill and his broader perspective, just it always makes for great stories.
I'd say for photographers, Alyssa Shukar, she is with Flyover Media, I think, or has done some work for them. She did some amazing work up in South Dakota with the Dakota Access Pipeline. And then also Danny Wilcox Frazier, he's from Iowa and does tremendous and kind of quirky work. I mean, if you really want to see, I think I would say Midwest lifestyles in small towns, Danny's the photographer to watch.
At the risk of plugging one of my clients. I have to give her credit. The person I have in mind is Louise Redcorn. She is the editor, owner, publisher, and as she puts it, COO and whipping boy of the Big Heart Times. Her background, though, was stints with the Detroit Free Press and the paper in Louisville, Kentucky. And she has a knack for cutting through the bullshit. Pardon my French. And there is a lot, I mean, it's, you know, rural Oklahoma, just like any other rural area, there's a lot of bullshit to cut through. And she's also a very good photographer and just has a knack being in the right place at the right time and painting a picture of what's going on in Osage County that you don't necessarily see in the Tulsa World or in the Pawhuska Journal Capital.
I think Joe Street's depth reporting classes and some of the projects they've done, more recently like the white clay issues, some of the reporting they're doing, if you haven't checked it out, you should. And you know, for me, Joel Satori's in our backyard. That guy's just amazing. So those are my two.
I also just want to stick in an extra plug for not just thinking of people who are covering small towns or who are covering rural areas as something that is kind of isolated. And the person that I would point you to for something like this, Pamela Colliffe, who has been a staff writer at Texas Monthly for 20-some years and finally got poached by the New York Times Magazine just recently. But she's covered the criminal justice system and especially the prison system in Texas for a lot of that time. And it's remarkable to me with all those years of coverage how you see how small town Texas intersects with the prison system, where the prisons are situated, who the people are who are in the prisons as inmates, the people who are working in the prisons. And it is a kind of portrait of Texas that I mean, I think that her reporting on the prison system maybe tells us more about Texas than, you know, any number of stories about big hats and cowboy boots.
If you have a really quick question. trying to think of final thoughts. Well, I probably now have 10 seconds. So I'll just wrap it up and say, thanks a lot for listening to us talk. Anyone, I don't want to leave anyone out if they have a final thing. But you know, make a list of all those people and go see what they do. And I think the reason that this interests me is because I want to reach for that kind of level of work and make myself better and sort of redouble our efforts through Harvest and NET to cover these areas in a full portrait and not a caricatured portrait of these places. Thank you.
Thank you so much to our panelists and to Grant, who did a wonderful job moderating here. We're going to take about a 10-minute break, and we're going to come back for our keynote speaker, Rachel Miss Libby. So if you want to get up, stretch your legs, feel free, and we'll see you soon.